Professor of Nuclear Reactor Physics at TU Delft, and also the coordinator of the European SEMAFAR project. I'd like to welcome Han to come on up and speak.
SEMAFAR is a European project in Horizon 2020 with 11 partners, and we are working on the molten salt fast reactor, but many of our findings and many of our experimental setups, etc., are I think very useful for all the startups and other companies that we have seen here this morning as well. So, the aim of the project is to prove the innovative safety features of MSR. And these are various, from freeze valves, from the retention capabilities of the salt. All these kind of things we have investigated in the SEMAFAR project, but also to create a consortium of stakeholders to move on with the project and with the results that we achieve in the project. So the main results are a kind of experimental proof of the main innovative safety features of the MSR or the MSFR and an updated concept of this reactor concept. And as said, we also want to see how we can continue with the project and together with stakeholders to make the next move. We have several work packages, six of them, and two important ones is one and six. One is about the integral safety assessment and the update of the reactor design of this MSFR. And the other important project is of work package is at the end, that is education. I think that is equally important as doing the work, because if you have no workforce in the future, every initiative is doomed to fail. So in work package one, we have the integral safety assessment of the reactor, and we want to understand the dynamics of a molten salt reactor. So we are building a simulator with the primary and secondary circuit attached to each other to see how the dynamics of a molten salt reactor work and how you can actually start up and slow shut down and load following, etc. How you can do this with a molten salt reactor. It's not that obvious actually from the beginning. And we have made a new innovative safety assessment method for molten salt reactors that is supported by the Generation 4 initiative. And with that, we think we can continue together with the regulators to a real reactor design. Okay, this is some characteristics. I will not go into detail in this reactor design. I think this is not the most interesting part of the talk, but we have salt of about 700 degrees C. This is lithium fluoride, and we have two fuel salts. The primary one is a lithium fluoride with thorium fluoride and some own bred uranium-233 in it, but we have also an alternative salt with true loading, so in which you can burn plutonium and minor actinides and all the other stuff of light water reactors, etc. We have a strong negative feedback coefficient. It was mentioned already that salt expands if it heats up, and that is a very strong force to reduce reactivity if the salt heats up. And with that, I will show you can easily do load following with a molten salt reactor. It was mentioned already in one of the talks before, but I will show you some results of a simulator that shows this aspect. Here you see the reactor design, the core design. This is all the fluid, so red and green here. This is the blanket. And here you have a pump, heat exchanger, etc. So the salt flows like this through the vessel. There is no moderator inside because it's a fast reactor design. And in total we have about 18 cubic meters of salt, 9 in the core and 9 in the heat exchangers and pumps. First, some results of the simulator. We have actually two programs attached to each other, one for the neutronics, all the physics happening in the core, and one for the energy conversion system. It's really needed to couple these two. We have done before simulations with only neutronics, and that gives much, well, in some cases other results than if you have the coupled system. I show you some results. For example, here you see if you go from a power of 1.5 gigawatt up to 3 gigawatts. If you do it slowly, so by extracting more power, you reduce a little bit the temperature of the primary fuel salt and your power increases automatically. If you do it slowly, everything goes well. If you do it too quickly, then too fast, then you get some overshooting. You see it here, and then you get some oscillations. Very interesting, of course, from the physics and dynamics point of view. And this is the influence of the energy conversion system. Before, we had a simulator with only the primary vessel, the processes in the core, and then you don't see this effect at all. So this is really a kind of interplay between the various loops that you have in your reactor. And so you need to model all the loops. If you have 3 loops, you need to model all this to see what happens dynamically with your reactor power if the power demand increases or reduces. In any case, you see that load following is possible. You can see that in a few hundred seconds, 100 to 200, you can increase or decrease with a factor of 2 in your reactor power. Work package 2 is about safety-related data. I didn't hear much about this today, but you really need fundamental understanding of your salt and of all the properties of your salt. For example, heat conduction, viscosity, whether or not fission products will remain in the salt if you heat up the salt to extreme temperatures, or if you get precipitates in your salt if you cool down too much. All this information you need to know also for the regulators at the end if you want to build a loop or a reactor. So we also investigated, for example, the status of the salt in the decay heat removal tanks, in the draining tanks, because if you would have a tsunami and water would come into contact with the salt, you don't know what the radiation of the fission products is doing with the salt in contact with water. So that's also something that we investigate in some of our projects. And of course, retention properties of iodine and cesium, which are the most important nuclides in case of accidents. But first you have to synthesize the salts. Here you see some pictures of uranium fluoride, thorium fluoride, and plutonium fluoride that were made at the GRC in Karlsruhe to make the salts that we are investigating. And one of the things that we are doing is to look at cesium and iodine in the salt and what happens to these if you heat up the salt to extreme temperatures. And you have more cesium than iodine in your salt, so you have a surplus of cesium. Iodine will typically bound to cesium iodine, and the rest of the cesium is bound with fluorine and get dissolved in the salt. The cesium fluoride remains in the salt, so that's no issue. The cesium iodide, there's a very short temperature range in which the cesium iodide may come out of the fuel. So that's something that we have to investigate in more detail to make sure that it always remains in the fuel if you heat up too much. That's something for further research. Another aspect is the properties of the salt, so heat conduction, all these kind of thermal physical properties that you need to know of all kind of different salts, also of the salts with uranium in it, with thorium in it, with plutonium in it, with the fission products in it, etc., corrosion products. In Delft we are making a viscosity meter that can measure viscosity of very, very small amounts of salt. Because of all these different kinds of salts that you want to investigate, you have only minor amounts in the beginning, say less than a few centiliters or so. So we do it with a sound method, so we have a transducer on top of a bar, and we via ultrasonic sound we can measure the viscosity in this small amounts of salt. So the third work package is about experimental validation of our code systems that we also developed. That's work package 4, where we want to investigate natural circulation dynamics. For example, we want to extract the decay heat from the primary circuit without draining. That our first target would be to keep the salt in the vessel. But that means that you have a kind of loop with an internally heated salt. And that's different from what you have in a, for example, natural circulation boiling water reactor. We also look at freeze plug designs. We also look at the freezing and remelting of salt against cold walls, etc. I'll show you some setups. Here you have the Suarez facility at CNRS in Grenoble. It's two vessels, left and right, with a tube between, and you can move salt from one vessel to the other via air pressure. And in between you have a glove box with the argon flushing to do all kind of experiments on the salt that is flown from one to the other vessel. And with that you can, for example, have mock-ups or freeze valves, and to test these, or you can look at the freezing of salts along cold walls and see how quickly they remelt if you heat up these solidified layers. Here, for example, you see a picture of the cold plug that CNRS designed, and that was tested in the loop system. So, and it worked. If you shut down the power, then after a few minutes it melts, and the salt flows into the tank. One other interesting thing is the loop that's being built at Polymy. Here you have this internally heated salt. Left, if you have a heater here, which would be a reactor core and a boiling water reactor, you have a heater here and a cooler there, and then you have a big difference in density between one and the other loop. In a molten salt reactor, this is different. If you have natural circulation of your salt, due to fission products, you have a gradual increase of the temperature, and that makes the dynamics very much different. To show you some results, I will skip this one. Measurements are now going on, so that these are expected in 1 month from now. But we have some results already from work package 4, in which we do the numerical assessment of all kind of things, where we develop the leading edge software that we need to do the transient analysis and to see what happens to the salt if it solidifies and how quickly it melts. And yeah. But also the dynamics of this loop system was investigated. And you can have several situations, several power densities in your loop system. And if you have very low densities, everything, well, is quite gradual, you could say. Here you see some numerical results calculated at EDF, TU Delft, and Polymy with all state-of-the-art code systems, you could say, but one is one-dimensional, the other are three-dimensional. But even in between the three-dimensional results, you see big differences. So very small differences in turbulence models or in starting conditions, etc., already gives big differences in the outcomes of your simulations. But you see big oscillations sometimes in your loop. And this is even worse if you have a high power density. So if you have natural circulation with salt that is, well, with a high concentration of fission products, you see wild oscillations, and you see even reversal of flow. So you, one time the flow is clockwise, and the other, after 10 seconds or so, it can be counterclockwise. So if you would have this in a molten salt reactor, this would give quite impressive forces on your primary circuit. So that's something you want to avoid, that's clear. The draining tank is also an issue. Actually, I see many simple concepts of draining tanks. We found that it's not so simple at the end to safely store your salt, because if you drain the salt in a drain tank, you have to take care that you can get rid of the heat. And salt is a high Prandtl number, and it means that the conduction is low compared to the convection. And so the salt is now stored in between assemblies that are cooled from the inside here, and this is salt, and this is these are the walls, and you have only a small volume to store the salt, because if the salt would solidify against the wall, then you have a barrier, extra isolator, and you cannot get rid of your decay heat anymore, and the salt can even boil inside. So just dumping the salt in a big tank doesn't work, at least not for this power densities. Then work package 5, chemical processing, that's the issue. Some concepts have no chemical processing attached. In our MSFR, we have it attached to the reactor design. It's also a big reactor of 1.5 gigawatt electric. And we've calculated the extraction coefficients to see how many stages of each step you would need. And at the end, also to design how big the walls need to be to protect the workers against radiation, how large the hold-up tanks of gaseous fission products need to be, and all these kind of things. So you see here that the I will not go into detail through these steps, but you see here that the processing takes several steps, 9. Some of them are in core. This is the helium bubbling step here. And some of them are out-core, that is all these steps here. And you first do the fluorination, for example, to get rid of uranium and some other fission products. Then you do reductive extraction here to get rid of the actinides, and then get rid of the lanthanides, and then reassemble your salt in the right composition and move it back to the reactor core. And then also very important topic is dissemination and training. All the institutions had many bachelor and master and PhD students working on these topics, and I think this is very important because you want to educate the workforce that we need to really scale up this technology. And in the TU Delft, for example, we had about 20 bachelor and master students working on this topic for their thesis projects. We also had a school in 2017 in summer, and next year we will have a workshop for stakeholders where we will present all our results. And so if you are interested to join, it's open to everybody, but we have limited space. But if you are interested, please send me a mail and I will put you on the list, and you will get an invitation beginning of next year. So that is the 2 days workshop where we will present all our results that obtained in SAMOVAR. Conclusions. SAMOVAR is on track. We had some minor delays in experimental setups, but I think if you have no delays in experimental setup, then you can wonder if you are doing real new work, because many times if you do something new, then you get unexpected things, and we saw many unexpected things happening in our experiments. We publish a lot. I think compared to other European projects, we do really very good on publishing at conferences and journals, and also the high impact journals. So from a scientific point of view, we do a very good job, I think. And we see also the community growing. We have every year, twice a year actually, a meeting with the Generation 4 community, and there is interest more and more from other countries every time. So I think you can easily say that SAMOVAR is the European contribution to this Generation 4 initiative as well. And it's attracting a lot of students. And this is important, because if you work at the university, you have to realize that we compete with other fields that are maybe more sexy to young people, like nano and quantum and life sciences, etc. So you need to have a challenging topic if you want to attract young people to the nuclear field. And a molten salt reactor with thorium in it is really one of these challenging fields, and it's attracting a lot of attention of young people. And with that message, I would like to finish.
This is 19 minutes, so we got time for a question.
What comes after SAMOVAR?
Ah, good question. I hope this question would come, actually. So we have submitted a new proposal, and SAMOSAVER it is called, and it will focus even more on all these phenomena that we have discovered and that are typical for MSR. Also, startups at some point will have to find a solution for these kind of topics. So it's about the focus is on simulation models and simulation tools, so software. For all these phenomena that happen in molten salt reactors, but not in other reactors, and together with the experimental validation. So we are building experiments and developing a lot of software, for example, for the freezing of the salt and the remelting, these kind of phenomena, for radiative heat transfer to model that correctly, and there's plenty of other topics in it. And we have seen that many partners want to join. We could easily be twice as large as we are now, and I apologize for the ones that were excluded. But you have to focus. And yeah, I hope next time the funding is twice as large so that we can include more partners as well.